technology is a case of quantum gravity.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's a really great pleasure to hear in Brazil. It's the first time for me in Brazil, and I'm enjoying a lot my visit. So, as Nathan already anticipated, the talk today is, let's say, focused on quantum technologies, and more specifically on quantum batteries, which is a topic that I worked on quite a lot in the last few years, and what I'm going to talk are, let's say, the main, let's say, achievements that we as a community reached in the last few years. So, this is an outline of the talk. I will start by recording you the notion of quantum revolutions. We have so far, let's say, two quantum revolutions, and I will record a little bit of both. Then I will tell you a little bit about what do we mean by quantum technology and which are the main principles that, let's say, are involved in order to develop quantum technologies. And then I will give you, let's say, a step-by-step guide on how a quantum technology can arise. And finally, we will go to the main topic of the talk, which are quantum. There is, I will introduce them, then I will introduce a notion that we developed, the notion of quantum charging advantage, and then I will talk a little bit about the open problems and what we hope to do in the next few years, and then of course some conclusions. So as Nathan already anticipated, please interrupt at any time such that we can make the talk, let's say, more interactive and maybe more funny for everybody. Okay, so let's start by the quantum revolutions, the first and the second. Now, the first quantum revolution is something that we are now used and we learn in our undergraduate, is, let's say, the quantum revolution that took place around the 20th century. And the main names for these revolutions are well known to all of us. They are Planck, Einstein, De Broglie, Heisenberg, Schrödinger, many others. Now, if we want to, let's say what the first quantum revolution did in a single sentence, we can say that during the first quantum revolution, we learned new rules that control the physics at very small scale. And again, if we want to, let's say, summarize the full revolution in a couple of sentences, I like to, let's say, bring this quotation. It's not really from De Broglie, but I assume that De Broglie would say something like that. And De Broglie essentially told us that electrons are also waves. And at the same time, Einstein said, well, also light is also a particle. And the particle is a photon. And so by taking these two sentences together, we go to what we tend to call the wave-particle duality, which is essentially the statement that a certain phenomenon can be thought as particle or wave, depending how we watch it at it. And this revolution already brought us a plethora of technological applications, for example lasers, for example semiconductors. This is something that in Korea they know very well because most of their industry is based on semiconductors, and so on and so forth. Now, the second quantum revolution, I believe that will be, is already being in my opinion, but will be the revolution of the 21st century. And here the main names are still under debate. For sure I think there will be Kitaev, for sure there will be Shor. Maybe some other, maybe even some of you in the audience could be the next author, the next actor, because it's something that is really happening right now. Now, again, if you want to summarize the revolution, we can say that now we are at the stage in which we can build, evolve, and measure quantum states. So, in a sense, in the second quantum revolution, we are not only making use of quantum phenomena. What we can do now is to engineer small quantum systems to perform some specific tasks that we want to perform. And here I like very much to quote this beautiful, let's say, review paper in 2003 by Dowling and Milburn, in which they say, the first quantum revolution gave us new rules that govern the physical reality. The second quantum revolution will take these rules and use them to develop new technologies. So this is essentially the stage at which we are. Now, I talk about quantum technology and quantum revolutions and so on and so forth, but what are, let's say, the principles? What are the physical principles that guide the new quantum revolutions? Okay, for this I think it's convenient to take a particular example, and we can, for example, compare a classical computer, the one that we use, and the quantum computer, the one that is coming, hopefully. For example, in classical computer, the unit of information we know very well is the bit. And the bit can take two values, 0 or 1. And using some cat notation, we can say that we have, let's say, spin up, spin down. So we have two possible values for the bit, 0 and 1. Now, a quantum computer is based on replacing the unit of information, the classical unit of information, the bit, and replace it with the quantum unit of information, which is the qubit, which is essentially, since we are all well trained, is essentially a two-level system, a quantum two-level system. So we know that this allows us to get a much richer setup, because essentially we have the two main ingredients of the quantum world are the superposition, which is telling us, the superposition principle, that a qubit can stay in the state 0 and 1, and this is just classical, but then we can have anything in between. So we start to develop superposition between states 0 and state 1. And indeed, we know that the space of all the possible states for a qubit can be mapped to the famous Bloch sphere. Now, the other crucial point at the base of anything quantum is entanglement, which is essentially the superposition principle applied among several qubits, not just one. So, for example, we have two qubits. Classically, they could stay 0, 0, 1, 1, or 0, 1, 1, 0, and that's it. But quantum, we can promote them to a much richer setup by making entanglement, which is the superposition, for example, of the 0, 0 plus 1, 1 state. So these are the two main principles. Now, out of these two main principles, how a quantum technology arises, at least ideally? Well, I think that we can divide this in a step-by-step guide in essentially three steps. The first one is definitely the most creative one. It's the step that I used to call the conception. It's the moment in which our imagination comes into the game. And suppose that we have a classical system that is able to solve some specific task. Now, by imagination, as I said, we start to idealize that there might be a quantum analog for the classical system. This is definitely the most creative moment. It's the moment in which we figure out that a certain classical system could maybe be replaced by a quantum system. And this is the hardest, in some sense, part. Indeed, for quantum computer, the main authors here is Feynman, so not just a standard physicist, Feynman. Now, the second step is the step at which normal people, like I could be, start to enter in the game and start to do something. It's the moment in which you develop the theory. It's a little bit simpler, in some sense. In a sense, during the theory step, what you do, now that you have this analogy, so you have a quantum analog corresponding to a classical system, you start to ask questions like, which tasks I can solve by using the quantum system instead of the classical one? And the main questions that during the theory you have to develop and you have to answer are these. For example, you start to ask, can I solve some new tasks? Or maybe I can solve the same tasks, but in a much, much, much better way. And these kind of questions are the basics of looking for quantum advantage, which is the possibility of using the quantumness feature of our technology to do something that we couldn't do classically. And notice, this is really the key step to justify, for example, to funding agencies, the full enterprises. Because building a quantum technology is extremely, take a lot of energy, a lot of money, a lot of time. And so the only, reason to invest all these energies and this time and so on in this business is if we can convince, first of all, ourselves and then funding agencies and so on, that we can get some quantum advantage. And then finally, there is the last step, which is, of course, the most interesting for general population, are the practical developments. Out of the theory, let's do something experimental. Now, our talk today is on quantum batteries, and so these steps can be, summarized in this way. The first step is the conception, and essentially, we look if we can use quantum systems, not classical, quantum systems, to store energy. And this will lead us to the notion of quantum batteries. Then we will develop the theory, which essentially means we will look for instances of quantum advantage, and in particular, we will talk about the quantum charging advantage that I also participated in developing, the notion of quantum charging advantage. And then finally, more speculative, we will talk a little bit about experiments, not so much, because I'm not so expert in experiments, but a few things. And then also further developments, so what we can do next, maybe when we will have some experimental, let's say, practical result, and so on and so forth. Okay, let's start. Let's start again from the very beginning. We are talking about batteries, so what a battery is. Well, an example of battery that I like to introduce typically is the case of a mountain dam. In a sense, a simple mountain dam is already a battery. Why? Well, the mountain dam is keeping water on top of the hill. And of course, the water doesn't like to stay here. The water would like to fall down and go to the valley. But we keep it there. So by keeping water there, we are storing energy. Indeed, we know that when the water starts to fall, this will make the turbine spinning, and this will produce work. So we are storing energy by keeping the water up in the hill. Then, what do we mean by charging the battery? Well, in this case, we know that when the water is down in the hill, there is no energy remaining. What we have to do to recharge our battery is simply to take the water and bring it up again. And this is what climate essentially is doing for us. Now, so this is, let's say, in a sense, an elementary example of a battery. A little bit less trivial is the case of the galvanic batteries that we learned probably in high school or something like that. Now, in the galvanic battery, the principle is exactly the same. The only difference is that now what is carrying the energy is not the water anymore, are the electrons. The electrons, in this case, would like to stay on the Cu piece of metal, but they are put in the zinc, and when we make a connection, they are free to flow and go to the Cu, and in this way they can do some work. For example, our lamp will work. Now, what do we mean in this case by recharging the battery? I mean, probably this battery is not rechargeable, but okay, let's assume that we can. What we can do is to bring the electrons back from the Cu to the zinc, such that they are already again in a situation in which they want to move and do something. So the general lesson out of these two examples is that a battery has something, some stuff, which is brought forcefully where it doesn't like to stay. Our thing, like water, electrons, and so on, would like to stay elsewhere. They are brought forcefully in another place, and in this way they store the energy because they want to go back to the original configuration. Now, after these preliminaries, the idea of quantum battery probably becomes much more intuitive, because now quantum batteries are simply batteries in which our stuff is not anymore electrons, it's not anymore water, but our stuffs are qubits. And this idea has been developed first by Alici and Farnes in 2013, in which they started to think about the possibility to store energy into the qubits. And quoting from their abstract, they really started to introduce the notion of quantum batteries, and you should see the similarities with the introduction to quantum technology. They thought small quantum mechanical system that is used, quantum that is used to temporarily store energy to transfer it from a production to a consumption center. And then the key point, we may wonder whether using processes that entangle, so that use the quantum feature of qubits that entangle two identical copies of a given battery, can yield a higher energy. So this is the key for the quantum advantage. They were starting to think about using qubits as batteries, but not only using as batteries, but start to get some quantum advantage due to the fact that we have a quantum feature entangled. This was, let's say, the starting point of all the business. Let's introduce a little bit more technical things, not much. As we said, we have qubits. So the key ingredient in order to build a battery is to create a preferred orientation such that our qubits, they choose an orientation and they would like to stay in an orientation, and the other orientation is the one that they don't want. This can be done in a lab, for example, with a magnetic field. So we can put our two-level systems, our qubits, in a magnetic field, such that, for example, we can say that the state in which the qubit is pointing up is the low energy, so this is the discharge battery, and the high energy, so the state in which the energy is stored in the battery, is the state in which the qubit is pointing down. So charging the battery means that we want to bring the qubit from this configuration to this configuration. And a little bit more technically, or let's say more mathematically, let's say, We can say that we create this preferred orientation by this Hamiltonian, in which we couple the magnetic field to the Pauli matrices along the matrix along the z-axis, such that this configuration, here I'm assuming, I don't remember exactly why, I'm assuming H to be negative, such that the low energy, the low energy state is the state with the spin pointing up, and the high energy state is the state with the spin pointing down, but okay, so this is the battery Hamiltonian, and then we can perform this, let's say, rotation from up to down by turning on a charging Hamiltonian H1, in which we turn on the magnetic, the Pauli matrix along the x-axis, such that this induces a precession and send the qubit from this configuration to this configuration. Again, a little bit more technical. To charge the battery, we do three steps. The first step, we prepare the ground state, which is the state in which the battery is discharged, and the energy could be put to zero or to the ground state energy. Then, at t equal to zero, we switch on the charging Hamiltonian, our sigma x, such that then we have a non-trivial time evolution, and psi evolve from psi naught, from the ground state, to a certain excited state. And then at t equal to tau, tau can be fine-tuned, let's say, we switch off the charging Hamiltonian, we will have a certain state that will continue to evolve, but its energy will not evolve anymore, and we will have a certain energy in the battery, which will be larger than the initial energy. So this is essentially what we are gonna do. Now, again, so far what I did is essentially to tell you an idea on how you can build a battery using a quantum system, but again, nobody will finance your research if you don't show some more spies. So what we have to do is to hunt for quantum advantage. And what we can do is to say, we can remind that the key quantum aspects that have no classical analog is entanglement. So we can, and we know that entanglement is the superposition applied to many qubits, not just one. So what we can think is that in order to get a quantum advantage, we need the collections of batteries. So collections of batteries. So what we, for example, are considering are four qubits that they are discharged in this configuration and they are charged in this configuration. And the battery Hamiltonian become H, summation of all the Pauli along the z-axis. And now the main question is, what kind of H1 I want to turn on in order to get some sort of advantage? And specifically today, we will talk about the notion of charging power. So essentially, we will talk about this question, and we will ask, is it possible that collections of quantum batteries, like here, be charged at a faster rate than classical batteries? And if yes, so if we can charge them fast, what, essentially the technical question becomes, what kind of H1, what kind of quench Hamiltonian we need to consider in order to charge fastly enough this one? This is what we are gonna, let's say, address right now. So this has been a question that took several years and as usual took several groups. And now we are gonna, to, let's say, describe a little bit the steps that the various groups and so on did in order to answer this question. And by the end, we will have few, at least a certain number of answers to this question. So, first of all, wait. I need a final, very small piece of technique. So classically, so suppose that I don't want to use it, because to see quantum advantage, I need to compare with something that doesn't use the quantum feature. So let's say classically, what I could do is to charge these batteries in parallel. So I put two chargers, and mathematically, I mean, I put an Hamiltonian that is just the summation of the sigma x. Now, in this way, of course, I charge with the power that scales linearly with the number of batteries. And let's say for convenience, it's convenient to divide the charging power by the amount of charger that I put, which is, let's say, is like defining a normalized power. And of course, the normalized power is simply the power for a single battery, because I have two chargers, so I charge twice faster, because I have two chargers, but the kind of charger that I have to put are two, so the normalized power is simply the power of a single battery. This is one way to do classically this process. The other way is to consider two cells and just one charger, and here trivially what I can do, I can use my charger to charge the first via this Hamiltonian, which I turn on the Pauli X along the first spin, then I go to the other spin. In this case, both the charge, the normalized and the standard power are again the power of a single battery. So the lesson is that classically the normalized power, P divided the number of charges, is fixed, and it is just the power of a single battery. There are no collective effects. So now we are ready to go to the questions.
Sorry, can I ask a
question? Please.
So H1 rotates up and down, right? It doesn't transform just up into down.
No, correct. Dual rotation, yes.
So you have to, you act for a finite amount of time, which is a period of rotation.
Correct. Exactly. We are doing a Hamiltonian evolution, so yeah, you have to do an evolution that do the precession and send the, let's say, the up spin to the down spin.
So you tune the time to be sure that...
That is another point. I'm not planning to talk about that, but yes, your point is correct. You have to tune, because otherwise if you wait too much, you will go back again to the ground state. Yes, absolutely. I'm not gonna talk too much about the, this is raise another issue, that is the stability issue. Like, suppose that I forget to turn off, I don't want to go back to the original state. It's another topic that I worked on, but I'm not gonna talk about. Maybe we can chat a little bit about. But okay, so the lesson is that the normalized power is fixed classically. Now we want to see if we can beat this limit by quantum effects. And as I said, this is something that took several years. And the first result has been obtained in this, obtained in this paper, in this PRL paper by many authors, Campaioli, Pollock, Binder, Celery, John Gold, Vijayanampati, and Kavanmodi, which has been also covered by APS, by the APS, let's say, newspaper, in which the author starting to understand how you can speed up the battery charging by quantum physics. And again, coming to their abstract, they demonstrated that quantum mechanics, so quantum effects, can lead to an enhancement in the amount of work deposited per unit time, the charging power, when n batteries are charged collectively. So again, by using entanglement, we will see better more about this, but by using collective effects, let's say, you can get a speed up in the charging. And what they specifically did was to derive some analytic upper bounds for this collective quantum advantage. So let's explain a little bit their result. Okay, so to explain the result, we need a little bit of formalism, not much again. So to understand the result, we need to first of all figure out what is the generic charging Hamiltonian that we can write. And of course, we know that Pauli matrices form a basis for all the operators. So the most general charging Hamiltonian can be written as a summation of Pauli strings, which are simply product of Pauli matrices acting on various sites. And I use this J for a collective index that tells me in which sites the Pauli matrix matrices are, and I use K to indicate the maximum, the number of qubits on which this particular Pauli string is acting. Now, by using this formalism, which is general, the authors found that the quantum power is bounded by, okay, a numerical constant that we don't care too much, and is always smaller than the classical power times a certain function. And this function involves two quantities. Involves Kmax, which is the largest K among all the possible Ks, which means is the maximum number of qubits that a single Pauli string is coupling together. This is one author that is entering here and here. And the other, slightly different, is Nmax, which is the maximum number of terms in which a certain qubit enters. So suppose that we fix on qubit 1, and we ask in how many of these Pauli strings qubit 1 is entering. These are the two quantities that control this bound. So let's...
I have a question.
Yes, please.
Yeah, so something I don't understand. In the classical example you made, I thought, I understood that the Hamiltonian was independent, so there was no coupling between the batteries.
Exactly. Exactly.
Would correspond to a string of length one.
Correct. Correct. Yes.
So how can you compare the quantum advantage?
Well, good point. Essentially, a single qubit is what I can do classically. Let's say if I don't want to use any quantum feature, I can only turn on length one strings. So this is the classical protocol.
M max equal to one here.
Not only M max equal to one, but also K max equal to one.
Okay.
Then let's say more generally, let's say, so the best possible scaling that I can think of is to think about all the possible Hamiltonians, let's say. So in some sense I'm saying that how much I can be fast with the most general Hamiltonian compared to an Hamiltonian that doesn't use any quantum feature because treats each qubit independently on the other. Can I go on? Or?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, thanks.
Sorry, what is gamma?
Gamma is just a numerical constant.
Yeah, what constant?
Second?
What constant? Do they find the constant?
No, it's model dependent. It's just the point is that it doesn't, it will be clear here. This part, so this is what they found. Then they were looking for, let's say, a possible extensive quantum advantage, so an advantage that depends on the number of qubits that I'm coupling together. So in this formula, gamma is something that doesn't depend on it. Instead, what can depend on n is k max and a max. So I can make these two quantities n dependent in two ways. First are the global charging operations. So suppose that among all the Pauli strings that are entering here, one, at least one of them, the k max is a function of n and at most can be linear in n. So if I have this situation, k max will become something n dependent. So I have the chance that this divided by this, which represents the advantage, could be n dependent. Another possibility is what we call all-to-all couplings, in which I have an extensive or even super extensive number of terms, so number of Pauli strings in which a given qubit enter. And both enter in this formula. So in principle, what they showed is that at the level of bound, at the level of bound, the quantum advantage, which is this divided by this, could be even polynomial in n. So could be that you can find some h1 such that the charging in quantum, compared to the case in which you take our h1 just a single qubit, could have a speed up, which is polynomial in n, not even linear, but yeah, please.
Do you have to assume anything about the coherence that does not play a role? Here
I'm assuming that in a perfectly isolated setup and quantum will remain quantum forever. Yes. Thanks. Okay. Now, let's say a few words about the questions that this result found by Campagnoli and friends didn't answer. So the questions were still there. First of all, this is just an upper bound. Could be completely loose. We can always say...
I think I'm confused by something basic. I thought we wanted the power to be small, right?
No, I want the power to be large, because in that way I charge
fast. The power to charge or to discharge?
To charge. I want to charge my battery as fast as possible. So I want the power to be very large, such that I turn on the H1 in the very short amount of time I reach...
Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Okay, so this is just an upper bound. And we didn't know, we don't know if this upper bound is going to be loose or it's going to be tight. It could be, we can always put an upper bound saying this is smaller than infinity. But of course it's super loose, it's not going to tell us anything. So the first question was, can we find explicit models showing some sort of extensive, by the way, I'm using here extensive in a sense scaling with n. I'm not saying linear, I'm saying anything that's scaling with n is extensive. So the first question that was not addressed here was, can we find an explicit model? Then, this polynomial was depending on two quantities, as we said, k max and m max. Are both necessary? Just one of them? Which of the two? They didn't know. Also, as I said, this is a bound, so related to the first question. What is a tight bound? So essentially, what is the best speed up that we can have? Linear, quadratic, even more, this could be polynomial, so it could be very large. They don't know. And then finally, again, the most important, experimental platforms are around.
Can you just say a few words about what goes into this proof?
How goes this proof?
Yeah, yeah, just a few words. What's the
I don't remember exactly because I don't remember exactly how did they prove. I can tell you how we proved that they verified the better version of this. Essentially, here you have to put a bound on the commutator between H0, which is the standard Hamiltonian, and H1, because the power is essentially the commutator between H0 and H1. So you have to bound this commutator, the operator bound. And essentially, the crux, I spoil a little bit, but not much. The crux is that you can reconstruct this commutator in terms of a summation of other commutators which are easier to bound. So you replace this commutator with another commutator that is much easier to bound. But yeah, it's essentially methods of, let's say, functional analysis. You have to bound operators. You have to find the bounds over the best, the maximum eigenvalues of some operators. Okay, so here is what they found, and here is how we started to address some of them.
Sorry, please. You have to assume something about the energy spectrum and about the states.
No. Okay. Let's assume that the energy states are fixed and they are given by H0, which is this sigma IZ. So let's assume that H0 is given, and we want to play only with H1. So the assumption is just that H1 can be written as a summation of Pauli states, and H0 is what it is. Okay. Now, the first result in this direction came actually 3 years after in this BLL by Andolina, myself, Matteo Carrega, Marco Polini, and Davide Rossini, in which we started to find the answer. And the first answer that we found was the first model. We found the first model in this, in which this advantage was present. And in particular, we work on an SYK, such as the VAT-based charging protocols of quantum batteries with N quantum cells. We showed that the optimal charging power of these SYK quantum batteries displays a super extensive scaling with N. So the power was super extensive. So the renormalized power was was scaling with N. That stems from general quantum mechanical effects. So few details, very few. So what we essentially considered was an H1, a charging Hamiltonian, which was formulated in terms of an all-to-all model of spinless fermions. Now, looking more carefully, this Hamiltonian involves both the features. There are all-to-all couplings, because let's say each fermion is interacting with any other fermions, so there are all-to-all couplings, and so N max is going polynomial in N, is actually going like N to the cube. And notice, these are fermionic operators, so we have to translate to the, by doing the Jordan-Wigner, we had to translate to the spin operators, and when you do that, you discover that also K-max is linear in N. So we have both the ingredients, and indeed, maybe not so surprisingly, we found that the renormalized power was going linearly, while in the parallel case, in the case in which you don't use entanglement, was constant. So we found an extensive scaling. A posteriori, this scaling, although it looks linear, is not linear. There will be details tomorrow. Actually, tomorrow I will discuss more the details about this scaling. But at least we found the first example in which this extensive scaling was there. However, there were still questions. In SYK, we have both M max going polynomial in N and K max going in N. So we didn't know if they were both necessary. And also, we didn't know what was the best possible scaling in general. Now, for this specific model,
may I ask a question?
Please.
I didn't follow it exactly, but so you don't normalize here by the norm of H1 somehow.
I'm doing
the rate.
In this plot, I'm doing. I apologize.
What I'm saying is that of course if you take the norm of H1 to infinity, the time is zero. So you have many terms in the norm will be large. So doesn't this have to be taken into account somehow?
The norm of H1 is scaling linearly with N. The operator norm, let's say the maximum eigenvalue, let's say the norm that I'm talking about is the maximum eigenvalue. So this scale, this is a well-defined Hamiltonian in the thermodynamic limit, so goes linearly in N. So here I'm not normalizing, here I am. So let's say if I were not normalizing in this plot, we would see that the black line was going linearly, and this line was going more than linearly. Maybe quadratic, maybe not, and tomorrow we will verify that it's not quadratic, but it's more than linear. Now, so here we found, let's say, an experimental evidence, numerically, up to 16 qubits, so not too much, but not so few. Now, the analytical answer to this particular model came actually last year, in 2022, in this paper that we wrote together with Jeff Murugan from Cape Town, Jan Olle, at the time a student in Spain, and Juno Kim, at the time a postdoc in IIS, in which we found an analytical way to show the quantum advantage, and we did it by studying the delocalization of operators in non-chaotic quantum systems whose interactions are encoded in an underlying graph. We studied the delocalization properties of large operators, and this, as a byproduct, and this is something that I like very much, gave us a deeper understanding and a precise scale for this set of quantum matrices. This I like very much because you start from a fundamental problem, let's say the problem of delocalization of operators, which is something that is, let's say, academical, but then you find a sort of application to something more applied, like this SYK batteries. I don't go into the details because this will be the main topic for tomorrow Blackboard talk. So whoever is interested, I hope that tomorrow you will be here. However, so here we solved the issue, so we know that the SYK quantum battery was advantageous. We didn't know if it was the only one, we didn't have a general theory, we had only a specific case. But notice, we found this not as a bound, we found this as a precise answer. Now, the final step was done slightly later, in April 2022, thanks to in this collaboration with Dominic Safranek, who is my collaborator in IBS, and especially thanks to this wonderful student, Joo-Yeon Kim, who visited us for a few months. He's a student in Seoul National University. And we found the general theorem about the possibility of quantum charging advantage in this PRL, that again has been advertised in a beautiful way by this author, Surab Bacharji, in physics. So we show, in this paper, quoting again from our answer, we show that the maximum speed up that can be achieved is extensive in the number of cells, and now by extensive I mean linear. So to reach such a scale, a global charging protocol, so K max is the only ingredient, while instead M max was not playing a role. So we found that the best possible scaling is linear, and was given by K max. We say that this concludes the quest on the limit of charging power. Now, let's see what Joo-Yeon has been able to prove for us, essentially. So he took again the bound by Campagnoli et al. Formulated in 2017, and he was able to improve the bound by saying that a much better bound was saying that for any H1, this will be always smaller than the classical times this gamma that is, as we said, independent, is model dependent, but it is independent on N, times K max. So essentially what he did was to find a better bound in which all the dependency on M max was washed out. Now, explicitly, we understand that there is at most a linear scaling of the advantage, or if you want, a quadratic scaling of the power. And we learn that global charging operations are the only necessary ingredients. All two coupling are not enough. And so an example of a Hamiltonian that realized this, so we can say that this bound, not in mathematical sense, but say in physics sense, is tight in the sense that we have an example that explicitly realizes this quantum advantage, which is given simply by the product of all the sigma I x. Please.
In this H1, do you really need all the terms from I equal to 1 to n, or just the big n?
No, you need here a number of I that increase with n. So for example, if you just go up to n divided by 2, it's fine. You will get a power which is smaller by a factor of 2, but will continue to scale with n. So, but what you need is that the number of Pauli entering scale with n. So you need the global operation in terms. Okay, so let's give you an intuition on how this charge
comes up. So this Hamiltonian, do you raise it to which power to flip all the spins?
No. This is the Hamiltonian. This is sigma 1 times sigma 2 times sigma 3.
No, I understand, sorry. I meant this is not a unitary, right? This is the.
No, the unitary is.
Hamiltonian raised to the power some time, right?
Yeah.
What is that time?
Because the charging take the form of a cosine, so it's an easy.
So it's easy to work. So it's exact here.
Yes, it's exact. It's exact, and it is in terms of the frequency of the. I mean, yeah, it's a simple problem. I don't remember, but it's an easy function of omega. Let's say the energy split. Yeah.
So it's not clear to me what are the rules of the game here. So in speech one, it's not clear to me what are the rules of the game. So here, in H1, for example, now, so imagine that you add another term which is the product of all sigma y's.
Okay, that could even spoil the advantage, in the sense that it could even reduce the advantage.
Well, but imagine that you would get with that a factor of 2 faster. Would it count the factor of 2, or you have to normalize somehow by the norm your Hamiltonian?
Exactly. Yeah, sorry. Again, here, whenever I apply this bounds, I'm always assuming a renormalized version of H1, so in which I always take, let's say, a bandwidth, so a difference between the largest and the smallest eigenvalue equal to 1 or 2. So adding more terms from the point of view of charging power is not beneficial.
Okay, and then in the example that you gave before, you were talking about this YK model,
right.
So did you also normalize in the plot in the same way that you answered that, it was not clear to me what was the answer?
Absolutely. You normalize in such a way that the largest eigenvalue is 1 and the smallest is minus 1.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. Okay, so let's see conceptually what is going on.
Well, the idea is that at the quantum level, 2 qubits, as we said, form a new entity, because we have now entangled states. So the process of charging can be thought as you have this 0-0 state and you want to bring it to the charge state 1-1. Now, classically, if you don't want to use an entanglement, so if you want to do it like you were not using a quantum system, you have to do a path like this. You have to make a path induced by your Hamiltonian in which you always move towards a non-entangled state. Now, the idea, and this is something that we are developing in more detail, but the idea is that on the space of all possible states, by making use of entanglement, you can find shortcuts that bring you faster, not because you, and this is related to the question before, by renormalizing the Hamiltonian in such a way that the eigenvalues are always between plus 1 and minus 1, you don't allow the states to go faster as a speed. The best you can find is a shortcut in the space of all the possible states, such that you reach the final state faster because you find the shortcut. And ideally, something like that. I mean, at the quantum level, you can use a single charger and do a global protocols in which the precession is done by all the qubits together and they go to the charge configuration, while classically what you can do is to move, let's say, in a sequence, all of them. So this is, let's say, the essence is that you don't charge faster because you get higher speed. You charge faster because there are shortcuts that pass through entangled states. Now, a little bit of joke. This is something that we use to get people enjoy. So let's see some consequences of the global charging. Well, we found that by global charging protocol, you can have a speed up that is n times faster, where n is the number of qubits. So we decided to make a joke, or let's say a game, and we said, okay, what would happen if we can use this n times faster in our life? And we took electric vehicles as an example. Probably we took that because in Korea electric vehicles are becoming very popular. So a typical electric car can use even up to 200 cells, so let's say up to 200 units, 200 batteries. So in principle, if we could use this, of course, I mean, take it as a joke, but if we could use this technology, we would be 200 times faster, which would mean that instead of taking 10 hours at home to recharge your car, in just 3 minutes, you will have your charge completely charged. And if you go to the charging station, instead of 30 minutes, in just 9 seconds, you will be ready to go. So this kind of jokes make fizz.org, the popular media, to release this article, say quantum technology could make charging electric cars as fast as pumping gas. Of course, whenever people ask about that, I say that I'm not sure I will live long enough to see something like that, and I'm planning to live long. to conclude, let's see an example of experimental realization. So the first experimental realization came actually last year, in 2022, by an Italian in Australia collaborations, in which they build the first model of quantum battery, in which they consider, I'm not an expert in experimental, but what they did, they put essentially in a cavity in which there was an electromagnetic field, they put some organic semiconductors that behave like a two-level system, and they found that indeed they can be charged by the electromagnetic field. And they also found an hint of superlinear scaling of the charging power, although a posteriori it has been shown that this is not a genuine quantum effect. It's actually a classical effect which is triggered by a quantum effect, so it should be taken more like a proof of principle of even how a small amount of quantum, a tiny amount of quantum, can give interesting effects when combined with classical effects. Now,
what's the idea for this protocol to generate an all-to-all coupling?
No, here there is no all-to-all coupling. Indeed, this is not a quantum effect. Essentially, I can tell you it's what is called in the community superabsorption. So is the other way is essentially the time reverse of super radiance, which is easier to understand. So suppose that you have a series of qubits that are all in the excited state. Now, by spontaneous emission, so a quantum effect, one of them can decay to the down state and emit a photon. Now, this photon can then trigger stimulated emission such that the various other qubits start to decay, and this creates a cascade. Now, the time reverse of this is called superabsorption, and it is what they saw. But this is actually mostly a classical process because it is stimulated emission triggered by an initial hint of quantum effects, which is the...
So it looks similar to the laser.
Yes, exactly.
So why is it related to the talk?
Well, it's related because you can say that when you use this system, you can bring your qubits to the higher state in a fast way, so you can say that you are storing the energy in your qubits when they are in the higher state. It's, a proof of principle that you can use, the electromagnetic field to charge this in an organized way these qubits all together. But it's really, a first example, and it's not.
Yeah. How would you go about generating this products of sigmas experimentally?
Good question. That is the main obstacle. If you practically for the I'm not an expert, but for example in quantum computers or something like that, I think generating unitary that couple together all the qubits is out of reach. So let's say that this in a sense this is a negative result of our theorem. This idea of using Nmax, so using all the all-to-all couplings without collective charging, was good because it's easier to realize all-to-all couplings rather than a collective product of all the sigmas. So people were, in a sense, positive that maybe you can use this Nmax as a resource. In a sense, our theorem showed that no, you need really the global unitaries, and that is very hard to do. I don't think you can do in an extensive way, but suppose that you find, a way to create 4 sigmas, you can get a speed up, which is 4 times. It's not scaling, but it's already speed up. Okay, so another platform. So motivated by the fact that experimental platforms were not much, in this paper published last year, we studied the possibility of using another kind of technology, which is the micromaser, in which is essentially the reverse of the other case, in which you send two-level systems inside the cavity and they charge the electromagnetic field. Now, we saw that this can be thought as a promising example of quantum battery, essentially because we notice that the final state, notice here you are doing a dissipative dynamics because you send a stream of two-level systems, each of that interacts with the electromagnetic field and then it leaves. So effectively what you have to do is all the time that you finish an interaction, you have to trace out the qubit degrees of freedom. So ideally you would expect that the final state of the electromagnetic field will be a mixture, will be not a pure state. Instead, what we observed is that for some miracle of quantum of coherence in this case, of superposition, you can get a final state for the electromagnetic field for your battery, which is a pure state. So in principle, you could then discharge these batteries without taking care of the qubits that have charged. So this, in principle, is a great advantage, which somehow suggests that micromaser could be an interesting platform for quantum batteries. And interestingly, although, I mean, it's unrelated, let's say, I recently learned that Qiskit, the famous platform, is starting to introduce a library to do this kind of computations. Now, the hope is that maybe they introduce these libraries because they are starting to think about applications using, let's say, hybrid qubit and bosonic circuits. And so maybe micromaser could be a next platform. Another interesting paper is this one, published last year by the group in Genova, Mauro Sassetti, Dario Ferraro, and their students, in which they essentially try to use a quantum computer as a quantum battery. I don't know exactly the detail of the paper, but somehow they think that a quantum computer could be used for energy storage purposes. So this could be another direction for the future. I don't know much about it, but it's, let's say, tantalizing that, let's say, all the efforts for quantum computing could be relevant for quantum batteries as well. And okay, here I do a little bit of predictions. So comparing with quantum computers, it looks that quantum batteries are running faster, partly because essentially both the theory and the techniques and in part also the technologies are overlapping. So I might hope that by 2055 we would have something around. So you have to be.
How many qubits you need to have something?
Well, it depends, of course, for your electric cars, a lot. But I don't know, we may hope that.
So essentially, you don't want to computer in your car?
Yeah, exactly. I do that example to provoke people, but I'm not thinking that we will do it. But maybe for some super tailored application,
if you need to computer in my car, that's not for the battery.
Okay, so here are the conclusions. As I'm saying, that quantum technologies are getting closer, and quantum computers are probably the most relevant examples, but others are coming out. There are also quantum engines. Quantum thermodynamics is, let's say, a sub-branch of quantum computing or quantum information that is quite active. I showed my story about quantum battery, because somehow reflect my adventure in this field, but there are other things. And let me conclude by advertising my group in IDS. So what we do in general, the common theme in our research, as I try to say, is to understand, for example, how quantum chaos or its absence affects the physics of quantum many-body systems. And the idea is that then we would like to apply this knowledge to quantum technologies or other fundamental research as well. Here is the group. I'm the team leader. Dominic and Barbara are our senior researcher. They both work on quantum, let's say. Dominic is our expert in quantum thermodynamics and quantum technology. Barbara has been one of the founders of Quantum Chaos. And actually, Barbara will visit here in late August for a school in Quantum Chaos. Then we have Varinder Singh, our postdoctor, that is working on quantum thermodynamics and quantum optics, and for example, for the development of the micromaser batteries, knowledge in quantum optics has been crucial. And then we have a bunch of students, Cameron Bitter and Nitin Gupta are actually students from UCT with Jeff Murugan, that I'm also supervising with him. And then we had, now he left, Vahid Shagahi, who also worked on the micromaser part, who was visiting us from Insubria University, and now he got his postdoctoral position in Czech Republic. Here is, let's say, a bit of statistics of our group. So here is a set of our collaborators. There are a few in Korea, a few in Europe, for example, Luxembourg, Trinity College, Spin, a few in US, Stony Brook, Sanon Center, and also a little bit, we have some connection with some company, Rigetti Computing and Kunova Computing, which is a quantum computing startup in South Korea. And these are our results in a couple of years. We wrote roughly 20 research papers, among them a couple of PRL, one quantum science and technology. Roughly speaking, we got 150 citations in the first 2 years. We have been advertised, thanks to this quantum battery things, in more than 30 news websites. We got an award for a prize for the best research group in IDS last year. We organized 4 conferences, and we were able to, let's say, start 2 memorandum of understanding. One with the Insubria University and the other with the CNRSP in Italy. I think I can stop here. Thank you very much.
Can we also start with questions from the online people and then the group? Mm. So do you guys want to start? So I don't know if we can do it in order. Do any of you have questions? Matisse, Michael, was on you.
One thing that I didn't understand.
Yeah.
But of course, right, all these two levels, all these qubits, they have electron volt order of magnitude energy. If you want to have a real battery, why don't you miss an Abu Dhabi number here somewhere?
Well, let's say that, as I said, let's take it as a proof of principle for the moment. Now, you know, this is a common feature in basic science. You never know where and when the application will come out. If I have to bet my salary, I would prefer to don't do that, but suppose that I have to, I would bet that if there will be applications, the applications will be in some microscopic setup. Take the car example as an example to dream, but not as something to put something.
Okay, this I understood, but still, I think that I understood is that even if you have an Avogadro number of two-level systems, I think you don't have to entangle all of them. No. You can do it 4 by 4.
Exactly.
Okay, understand now. Thanks.
Maybe I want to remark this. You can get an advantage, which is not extensive, but still an advantage, if you just couple a few of them. It is already an advantage. So it's not either all or nothing. You can get something in between.
You had this product of polymatrices,
yes,
a lot of the X direction. Suppose I put some of them in the Y direction. Does it change anything?
No.
Does it completely decouple? So it doesn't matter. One doesn't care what the other one is doing.
They
have to be all aligned to speed.
So you say that you start to put some. Well, they are not completely decoupled because they are a product. Here is a product of sigma.
Suppose I put some of them in the Y direction. Why do you care?
You have to check. It could care, right? Because
they don't talk to each other. So
no, they talk because this is a global. I mean, they wouldn't talk if it was a summation. If it was a summation of sigmas, I completely agree with you.
It's in the exponent. But,
exactly. This is in the exponent of the unitary operator. If you change consistently all of them from X to Y, nothing changes. If you start to make changes, we have to do the computations, but it's not.
But I'm just asking naively, but you just have some basis. You happen to choose the same basis for all of them, but nobody cared if you change the same basis.
You cannot change the basis. If you want, the basis has been chosen by the H naught. Here you have two actors. So H0 have chosen a preferred basis. So you don't have the right, this is if you want the reason why Here I said the,
no, I'm going
okay, to it's not clear to me, but maybe you, if you can do the computation and show me you get the answers.
You see here, the fact that I have to translate the C operators, so the operators as fermions, to the Pauli basis is because H0 is formulated in, you have to express the two Hamiltonians in the game in the same basis. And H0 choose the computational basis up and down in the Z direction, and the basis is fixed by that.
So, I think
Rosario's
question is the same question. So, the classical
end,
there's no coupling at all, right? In the classical,
no, but this is not classical. I understand. Okay.
Yeah.
Conceptually,
laser can be considered a quantum energy transfer device.
A laser, I would say yes.
It uses quantum effect for meditation.
Yeah, I would say that, yeah, conceptually laser is an example of that. Let's say that you probably in laser you don't use many body setup, right? Because you have just like, for example, a three-level system in which you bring, let's say, excitation to the higher state and then you let it decay. So you consider a single system. So it's not a many body setup. Here you want to move to the many body setup in which you put together, but yes, yes.
Maybe can I ask a question?
Yes, please, just go ahead.
Yeah, so, okay, you showed that there was this product of all these sigma x's that it's best choice, but can you say more why you started, or the other people started, by trying with the SYK
Hamiltonian
as an addition?
Partly, okay, there were several reasons. One of them was that, as I told probably to Pedro, is that a protocol like this, although conceptually super simple, is extremely hard to realize in lab, because you should get a unitary operation that couple together all the qubits in a single instance. So when we did this guy, or let's say in general, was to say, can we, let's say, get rid of K max in favor of M max? Because at least let's say there are more hope to realize an all-to-all coupling rather than. So that was one reason. The second, that is something that I didn't explain during my talk, it is again related to a point that was raised by Pedro during the talk. In this sigma product of sigma AX, if you forget to turn off your battery, to turn off the charging, you go back to the ground state. So suppose that, I mean, it's not what you want. Now, in this SYK business, exactly because the model is many body chaotic, exactly for that, and exactly because your SYK model is thermalizing in the sense of ETH, you reach a final state for which the energy doesn't fluctuate anymore. So if you forget to turn off your battery, the energy will remain more or less the same. So these kind of SYK protocols are good. They are less efficient in terms of power, but what you gain is the fact that you reach a, let's say, a steady state. And so you don't risk to lose the charge just because you are not good enough in turning off.
But this would be also for any other Hamiltonian which satisfies ETH, no?
I would say yes. I would say yes. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks. Let me also, let me just add. No, yeah, I would say yes. Yeah. Is enough. Yeah, thanks.
So may I ask another question?
Yeah.
Maybe I misunderstood it, so I'm sorry if I misunderstood it, but somehow the problem is that you want to go from some initial state, which is all spinned up, to some final state, which is all spinned up.
Yes and no. Go ahead, but yes and no. Go ahead.
No, because if this is what you want to do, then the Hamiltonian, which switches from one to the other one, will be optimal, with the fastest, with the normalization that you chose, so it cannot be faster than that. So what am I missing with that? The Hamiltonian that will be all spins up, cat, and then the Brown all spins up, plus emission conjugate. I mean, that's the one that drives you from one to the other one?
That is the sigma X. That indeed is this. This one. This is, if you go in a basis, is exactly that, no?
No, I don't think so. So the Hamiltonian, because this is just a full rank, the Hamiltonian that I'm telling you is a rank 2, right? So.
Wait, is a rank 2. This is the product of all the sigma x, so. No, wait.
So the determinant of this matrix is 1, the one that I'm telling you the determinant is 0, because it has rank 2 only. I mean, it has only two states, it's up and all ups and all downs. But. But that's the one, so that's, I mean, you have, I mean, at the end you have two states only, right? I mean, you only care about the initial and the final one, then just forget about everything else and just write
right, wait, I'm doing a unitary evolution, so I'm doing a continuous evolution, so I'm not applying an Hamiltonian and take the final state. I'm thinking about doing a time evolution.
I need to tell you that the Hamiltonian, which is, let's say, you have like two levels. You have all spin ups and all spin downs. This is the goal. This is like a qubit. So you just put the sigma x for this qubit as the one that will go from all spins up to all spins down. And that's a Hamiltonian that has to be optimal for that. Is this one allowed? Because it will be a Hamiltonian due to the evolution. It will have rapid oscillations and will go from all spins down to all spin up in a period of, you know,
I think it's actually this Hamiltonian. Look, I think we all agree that the most general Hamiltonian can be written as a linear combination of Pauli states. I think this, we all agree.
Yes.
And I think the Hamiltonian that you are talking about is, well, anyway, for sure it cannot do better than this, because this saturates the bound. And given the bound, definitely, whatever you think, you cannot do better than this. This I completely agree. Now,
I'm not saying that it does better. I mean, I'm just saying that this is the optimal one. Because, I mean, you have two level systems, and people have thought what are the best way to go from one state to another one. And those are the ones, if you normalize the Hamiltonian. So that's what I'm wondering, if you were allowed to do like a good Hamiltonian that you want, because then.
I'm allowed to do any, as I said, I'm taking the most general H1 compatible with an extensive scaling but I mean, once I renormalized, if there are no divergences or whatever, I would say that the most general Hamiltonian can be written as a product as a summation of Pauli strings. And as I said, this bound is fully general, and you cannot beat it. Now, I can show you that this do the rapid oscillation that you are talking about with the maximum possible power. So definitely you cannot do better than that. Now, as I said, now you start to think also about other features, like for example, since as you talk about rapid oscillations, that would mean that if you don't stop at the right moment, you will go down again to the ground state. And that would make the control more complicated. So you start to think, well, maybe I can take an Hamiltonian that thermalizes, which satisfies pH, such that I reduce this problem, and so on and so forth. That is, as you say correctly, you give up part of the advantage in terms of power to keep some other feature. And for example, the SYK Hamiltonian, such that you do exactly as you still get an advantage, but with the good point that you reach a steady state, and the energy stay there. But actually, this is the answer. Now, as you said, everything from 111 to 000.
Product of all sigma plus, not sigma x. And then, of course, to make it termination, you probably want to add product of all sigma minus.
Yeah, it's product of, okay, yeah, but I would say that it's in the same, okay, good, yeah, thanks. It's a product of all the sigma, yeah, correct. So, it's the product of all the sigma plus the product of all the sigma minus. Because, but that sigma plus sigma minus is sigma x. Ah, but then, yeah, it's the problem. Okay, yes. Maybe you can get the best you can get is something better in gamma. So something that doesn't scale with n, maybe you can get a better factor in gamma. But definitely you cannot get better than this. So it's a close relative of this. Is the product of all the sigma plus the product of all the sigma minus, agreed. And the best you can get is something better in gamma. Yes, okay, okay, thanks, yeah.
So, can I ask a question?
Go ahead, Rosario.
Yeah? So, just to understand how do you get this bound? So, essentially, fixing the initial and final state is a way to minimize the expression for the speed limit?
No, possible
Hamiltonian or something else?
No. You want to take H naught, H1, so the charging power at the very end, the instantaneous charging power, can be written in terms of the commutator between H0 and H1. So now, the maximum charging power, you try to maximize the operator, let's say the norm of H of the commutator between H0 and H1. This is the way to prove. So you try to bound this commutator, you do the trivial, let's say, bound, and you get something that is non-informative. So you have to, let's say, work out another way to find a better bound. And the crux of the proof has been to show that this
Let me ask. But that's fine. But I would like to understand if there is something different from minimizing the speed limit.
In a sense, it's different.
I'm not sure if there is the same problem, but I would like to understand if this is correct or not.
Okay, let's say it's closely related. It's closely related, and indeed now we are working also on connecting towards the speed limit. Let's say. We didn't formulate in terms of a speed limit. Now, if you want, in this game in which I say I try to minimize or maximize the operator bound, the bound of the, I try to minimize, to maximize the norm of this operator, I'm not talking anymore about the state. Cioè, if you want, our theorem tell us that the maximum power is limit bounded by n, but I'm not saying in which state you get this power. I'm just saying that at most, with that H0 and that H1, there will be, during the evolution, a moment in which the power will be bounded by n. So if you want, is a bound about the instantaneous power. And indeed, Ju-Yong Kim, our student, very recently, a few weeks ago, wrote a paper about what are the states that get the best possible power. So in which state you can get this power. Our proof just show that at most you can get for a certain state that we don't specify, and we don't know in principle, you can get this power. But then characterize exactly that state is another problem. And it is something that Julian started to address recently.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Any other questions? Anybody? Okay, so just to remind, tomorrow at 2:00 in Brazil time.
Ah, okay. Yeah.
Okay, so thank you very much.